Thank you for tuning in to the Un-Bougie Foodie every Saturday at 10 a.m. where we talk about food and interesting topics about the community. Let's start our show. Wesley Wright, again here every Saturday at 10 a.m. right here on WEQY. Again, want to thank you for taking the opportunity to tune in. Those that don't have the opportunity of tuning in on their phone, you could definitely tune in through the TuneIn app, or stream the show live, I should say, through the TuneIn app. But also, please make sure you're following me on Facebook as well as on Instagram. You can find me on Facebook at The Un-Bougie Foodie. On Instagram, it would be The _ Un-Bougie Foodie. And of course, Twitter is also available that you could follow me on as well. You might hear a rant or two. Honestly, I don't really rant. I just kind of share maybe a point about food or so forth on my Twitter, in addition to making posts of when the next recorded show is going to be or is available. So you could find Twitter just simply at Un-Bougie Foodie. Gosh, you know, I'm looking outside and seeing that it's raining. Nice little storm that passed through earlier today. Made it difficult for me to get up. I'm just saying. It was a little difficult. That's okay, though. So, I hope I had an opportunity to just check out, past article. Well, I should say past shows. Because you know what this show is about. It is about food. We're always talking about interesting topics in relation to food. And I'm always going to mention something about maybe a farmer's market, a recipe, an article I found interesting. And I want to share that. I mean, there are one or two articles that I saw, if you would. And again, I wanted to make sure that I brought that to your attention. But even before that, I want to also say that, this is a show where it's interactive. So I hope you also are interested in maybe sharing maybe a food suggestion, or maybe something special that you've done with a particular recipe, if you would. Why not share that with us? Give us a call. Give me a call. I always say that. 651-200-3479. Again, 651-200-3479, where you can talk to me and share your food suggestions, comments. Maybe you need a recommendation. And that's all available through this show. So, again, that call-in number is 651-200-3479. But, article. I was looking in, I just happened to be in, I forget what part of town, I think I was in more Minneapolis or so forth. But this just gives you an idea of how, articles or publications can go throughout the cities, if you would. And it's the Carrot. So it's based on the Eastside Food Co-op publication. And, we are coming out of the summer season, but I still found it very interesting of a seafood article that they mentioned. And they talked about how, you know, they offer a selection of fresh fish, crustaceans, mollusks, and so on. I have to ask the question, just maybe for my audience listeners, what is your favorite type of, I'd say, seafood or cuisine when it comes, to seafood? I mean, is there something specific that you feel is your go-to that you are going to always have, or if it's on the menu somewhere, you're always going to pick it? Or are you willing to try different types of variations of seafood? There are so many different types of fish that I love. Salmon being kind of like at the top of the list. But then there's Chilean sea bass, trout, whitefish, yellowtail. Going into kind of like the sushi type of genre, if you would, but just fish in general. It's interesting that, you know, it's not something that's constantly evolving or changing. It's very consistent, and I think what it is that people are finding new and exciting ways to do fish. Whether it be adding herbs, maybe a herb butter, or they find a specific spice that they are interested in. I'm looking at a photo right now of a pesto. It's more of a pesto sauce that they're actually using on this fish that was roasted, along with, and interestingly enough, Brussels sprouts and tomatoes. And so it's a great looking dish. And of course I don't have the recipe for it, sorry, but actually I do. I do have the recipe for it, so we'll talk about that in just a minute. But again, this was more of our not really older article, just a month or so ago, but specifically at Eastside Co-op. They are offering all these different types of fish available, and you could even find them at, you know, grocery stores throughout the neighborhood or the communities. I mean, there are, a number of different places that you might be able to go. But salmon, fillet of salmon is what they offer. Again, crustaceans, mollusks. And I like how they indicated fillets, just plural, because it couldn't be a wide variety of fillets that are available. Just because we're going into fall does not necessarily mean that you have to change your cuisine from seafood. Yes, it is oftentimes a summer type of cuisine, seafood, specifically fish, because it's lighter. And there's, I suppose that there's not much heat that you're actually going to be using inside the kitchen itself. Although, there are folks that say that really summertime is more for barbecuing, being out on the grill. Well, likewise, you could take the fish on the grill as well. But there's nothing wrong with actually still having that part of your cuisine, even though we're going into fall. There are so many other different dishes and, what about pho? You could have pho, and I mean, there are a number of types and styles of pho that include some type of seafood, would be, or crustacean, if you would. So it's not, and plus, it's warm. It's comfort food. At least I'm learning more that it is comfort food, especially around this time. People are buying, you know, wanting to get pho more than ever. It's light, or it's lighter, not so many calories and carbs and so forth that are associated with it. It's a broth. Again, that's why I'm saying that it's light. But the different types of either meats or seafood that can actually be used in it. So you don't have to actually totally put away your thought process of, you know, consuming fish as we go into the fall season. But the article goes on to say that most popular items during this time period, or when they're having seafood, is the Atlantic salmon. It has a mild flavor, substantial texture, and it holds up well on the grill, especially if you like a nice steaked salmon, or steak cut salmon, I should say. Definitely putting that on the grill. It's great with marinades. And even sometimes, because it's so light and it doesn't have such a fishy smell, as some folks would want to say, my mother, love you. Kids will eat it too. They'll love it. You know, again, it is a very healthy fish. Lots of high levels of omega-3s. And it has a delicious taste, of course. So, we'll go into that recipe, though, specifically. And I found the name of it. It was, and it's trout, like I mentioned. Poached rainbow trout with parsley and walnut pesto. And I assume that it's probably one of the cooks there, or one of the chefs. Individuals that are coming up with these wonderful recipes and so forth, they're awesome. So first, let's start with some of the ingredients. The first, you want a whole rainbow trout, cleaned and butterflied. Now, mind you, I'm sorry, I'm gearing a little bit away from the recipe, but it's just to say that here's just an example. Rainbow trout is great if you want to use possibly a salmon or maybe a whitefish. You can do that as well. They're just using the rainbow trout as one type of fish that you are able to prepare this with. So again, if you'd like to follow the recipe, it is for the poached rainbow trout with parsley and walnut pesto. So again, one whole rainbow trout, clean and butterflied. Might have to get your butcher to probably do that, or one of the representatives there at your local grocery store. 3 lemon slices, fresh thyme, fresh tarragon, and there's parsley, rosemary, or dill that you could possibly use. So a mixture, though, of tarragon and rosemary sounds wonderful. So play around with those different spices, or those herbs, I should say. A mixture of, you never know, maybe even a mixture of 3 out of the 4 or 2 out of the 4 together can work wonders. The next thing you're going to do, though, is you're going to preheat your oven to 400 degrees. And then you want to place your lemon slices and the fresh herbs in the belly of the trout. You're then going to wrap that in foil. In a loose pouch, but still tight enough so that the moisture stays inside. And then you're going to put it on a baking rack and bake for about 10 minutes. You want that, when you are checking the fish, you want the flesh to be opaque or almost translucent. Translucent meaning, you know, light, almost... I say more of a lightly cooked color. And then, of course, you're able to tease it apart, you know, when you poke it with a fork. So that also would probably be a more a better way to actually describe how you want, you know, when you're the fish is actually done. So yeah, now we're gonna go to the actual pesto, and they describe it as again being a parsley walnut pesto. So you're going to use 1/2 cup of fresh parsley, 1/4 cup of chopped walnuts, 1 tablespoon of lemon juice. You will have some butter, and that will need to be melted, and then salt and pepper to taste. Now, you're going to add all those ingredients to the food processor or a blender if you have them, and blend them until they're mixed well, but still kind of coarse, because you want that, there's that texture that you want, I mean, with a pesto. It doesn't necessarily have to be chunks or large portions, but coarse. And then, you know, you're going to put that in a container. It's always best to have maybe a container, a jar, or something that you can actually place your pesto in. And then you're going to serve that on the rainbow trout. It's just going to be a fresh garnish that you're going to be placing on it. And again, that example that they've shown of the presentation, it actually looks quite amazing. You know, with the Brussels sprouts and the tomatoes, and I believe those might be carrots, I'm not sure. Interesting angle. But I will make sure that this recipe is available for you online. Please check back later today on the Un-Bougie Foodie, and that recipe will, that poached rainbow trout with parsley walnut pesto will actually be available for you. You know, to check out or to see. There is, you know, I didn't get a chance to share with you all, and you probably are aware, I probably mentioned it, but those that know maybe the food truck that this gentleman, this next individual or topic that I'm going to be touching on, the gentleman or creator of it, you know, Sean Sherman, the sous chef, he has produced a wonderful publication, or cookbook, if you would, and it's called The Sioux Chef's Indigenous Kitchen, and it's by Sean Sherman and Beth Dooley. I purchased it for October or July, and then got it in October, so I was really glad to get it. Today they are actually going to be holding a, well, like a book signing at 12:30 at Mill City Museum. So if you're interested, again, it's going to be a book signing from 12:30, well, at 12:30 and 2 p.m. So there's a small event, if you would, that's going on there in conjunction with his book publication. But as I was going through it, you know, in the past, I know I've always talked about how I want to tell a story or provide some type of backstory, if you would, to different foods, or at least find out about them or research them myself. But this is, you know, and other cookbooks, of course, that I've obtained also tell, you know, some type of story that's associated with it. Telling about the culture, telling individuals, the readers, about the person's background, how even they got involved with cooking and the different types of foods that they remember their parents cooked. And this is no different. I mean, this publication, I haven't gone through the whole entire thing, but, you know, I'm just thinking of all the different recipes that are here available in this cookbook. But it's almost like each section tells a specific story on why, how something was obtained. And the book itself, I mean, again, Indigenous Kitchen, you know, his intro or introduction and foreword to the book, he mentions that the book is dedicated to their ancestors and all Indigenous people who've suffered through centuries of colonialism. First Nation descendants, they are living proof of courage and resilience. They offer their work through this publication to the next generation so that they could carry on a flame of knowledge and keeping alive their traditions, their foods, their medicines, and so on. And I just thought it was, again, information that tells a story on why, how these foods were prepared. One day I hope to get like that. I would love to write a publication. I think it probably would be a memoir. I'm not sure if there are maybe food bloggers or influencers that they're not actual chefs, but they have created a publication that basically, you know, if they are really great foodies or food bloggers or influencers in that to their own right, that they have done a backstory on a particular culture to find out what's the meaning behind maybe a specific dish, or the reason why a chicken is cooked a certain way, or the types of vegetables that are used within a certain meal. I don't know if there is anyone out there that has created a cookbook just by, or not a cookbook, but more of a memoir of their travels, or they're going to tasting different cuisines, I should say, tasting different cuisines, and then telling their own story of their experience, not of the story of their cuisine. Their research, of course, would be telling, you know, in their writing, would be able to help them describe the food, how it was actually prepared. But their own memoirs themselves would actually invite you as listeners or as a reader to taste that particular cuisine. So I'm going to do some research on that. If there's anybody out there that knows possibly what, or if there is someone, or maybe a cookbook that, or a memoir that you could recommend that has that type of element, I would really love to read it. So you can either give me a call here, or and you know, call in the radio station, 651-200-3479. Again, 651-200-3479. Or you can send me a message on Facebook, The Un-Bougie Foodie. Or maybe you have links and so forth you want to add. Send me an email message, theunbougiefoodie@gmail.com. And yeah, we'll definitely make sure to share that information. But the Indigenous Kitchen cookbook, if you would, it talks about his growing up, the vegetables that were picked or harvested. I say that harvested. That was harvested when he was younger. The different type of plants that they would forage for, just almost on a daily basis. Sean Sherman has actually had a food truck, and a restaurant is actually going to be coming soon, but the food truck was called, or is called, Tatanka food truck. They at times offer pop-up dinners that weave that multicultural or multi-course dinners with it in indigenous culture and music, spoken word, poetry, and storytelling. I honestly feel that I have a lot to learn when it comes to this particular culture and cuisine. As going through the book, mentioned, there are certain plants, if you would, that we disregard or that are not, that are just quickly removed from a garden or maybe from your standard lawn or something. All of these different types of plants, and we won't say weeds because he's saying he no longer sees weeds but food and medicine. Again, when you are an person that is from an indigenous culture, they see the importance of usage of different, pretty much everything. That's really fascinating to me. I definitely do not want to give the perception that I know anything about Native American cooking or indigenous cuisines at all. So I'm really interested in just learning more and more. And I think this is going to be a publication that I'll be able to hopefully learn from. There are a number of the recipes and photos that go along with them are just quite amazing. Really nicely done. And just so you know, I'm talking about this because it's an exciting publication. Going just through flipping through pages itself when I first got it, and the recipes are using ingredients, some ingredients that, or spices, or you know, plants and so forth, that you really do have to do your research on and find out ahead of time. But they're very simple. Here's an example of one: a salad of grilled squash, apples, wild greens, and toasted walnuts. A small acorn or delicata squash. You're going to have that seeded, peeled, and then sliced into pieces that are about 1 inch long and 1/4 inch in thickness. One medium or two small apples. We're going to core those and then cut them into rounds. 2 tablespoons of sunflower oil. You're going to salt to taste. So that's important because we know that certain individuals, you know, they're for health benefits, they have to monitor their sodium intake. So keep in mind salt to taste. 1 teaspoon of chopped sage leaves. 6 to 8 cups of mixed wild greens. 1/4 cup of maple dressing. And in the book, it has a description of, you know, how you're able to make maple dressing, and it is really simple actually. Next is 1/4 cup of dried cranberries, 1/4 cup of toasted chopped walnuts. So you're going to brush the squash and the apple pieces with a little of the sunflower oil. You're going to heat a skillet, and then, or if you have a griddle, that's fine, over medium to high heat, and then you're going to pan roast the squash until they're nicely toasted on both sides and tender. That should normally take about 5 to 10 minutes per side, and then you're going to remove those and set them aside. The apples you're also going to toast again on each side, lightly brown them. Well, 1 to 2 minutes per side is what's suggested. And once again, you're going to remove those and set those aside. Now we're coming to the actual greens, the actual salad portion of the salad. Sounds wrong. The actual vegetation for the salad. You're going to toss the greens, the sage, and the cranberries with the dressing. That is that maple dressing. And then you're going to arrange that in a bowl or a platter. Presentation, again, is everything. When you're a person that visuals are so important, because it invites people to actually, oh, that looks good. I'd like to have some of that. Yeah, and then they taste it, and then they're like totally freaked out and everything, because then they want more. That maple dressing, though, really quick, it's more of a sweet and sour type of dressing. And you know, I haven't heard this word anywhere else other than in Belize culture, but sour sap. It's fermented apple sap, maple sap, and it's traditionally used to season roasting meats. But for this maple dressing, for that salad, you're going to make 1/4 cup, or use 1/4 cup of maple vinegar, 1/3 cup of sunflower oil, 2 tablespoons of maple syrup, or you could add more if you'd like to taste, and then just a generous pinch of powdered mustard, or maybe a teaspoon of Dijon mustard, and then salt to taste. All of those ingredients are going to go into a small jar, and you just simply shake it. There's no blender that's needed, or anything. So, yeah. I love how it's kind of this dressing. It's apparently based on that traditional sour sap. Or again, fermented maple sap. You know, Belizeans say that quite often sometimes. There was, you know, remember I said that there were kind of stories in certain sections. Here I'm looking at one that is specific to bison. And if you've never had bison, I think. I know I have not had any type of bison steak or maybe a roast or anything of that nature. I think I probably have had a blend of bison, beef and bison, or bison and venison. No, excuse me, beef and bison, excuse me. In a burger, or just having a bison burger. I think someone has that. I believe it is Red Cow. So if you ever go to Red Cow, get that bison burger, because it's very good. But in this Indigenous sous chef's Indigenous kitchen cookbook, which I'm really enjoying, it gives a little story. They are, you know, they are always, Chef Sherman mentions that they were always present, that bison was always present when he was growing up. It's a symbol of the relationship. The bison is a symbol of, or symbolic of, the relationship that we have with the earth to one another. There was a Native American poet and historian, his name is Joseph Marshall, that said that the animal has to be kept alive for generations, providing us with food, clothing, medicine, tools. And Indigenous folks honor the bison by how they are preparing the meat, or how they are basically respecting the animal, and how important it is to the Indigenous culture. The meat itself, he mentions that some older people say that bison reminds them of the beef that they ate when they were younger. It's a lot leaner. It's lighter, but still richer in flavor or taste. And it's not, it's delicious, but can still be overcooked very easily. Low and slow is what they suggest. But, you know, still high and fast could actually work just as well. So you have to find a specific balance, or a happy medium, so that the bison doesn't get overcooked. It is a meat that is high in protein, low in fat, and low in cholesterol as well. It's grass-fed. They're grass-fed bison. So even with, you know, a land animal such as this, it still has or possesses a good source of omega-3 fatty acids, which is good for the body, or for your the human system. If you don't have bison in the area, which I think it can be I won't say a commodity, maybe a specialty, maybe at your butcher. If you don't have it available, you could always use grass-fed beef, to substitute for any recipes or whatnot. Yeah. I skipped about 15 or 20, maybe 30 pages or 40. Literally, this book, it actually goes from through all the different, chicken, or I'll say small game fowl, such as quail, duck, to larger animals, rabbits, and so forth. But it covers a wide range of stuff, too, because even I'm looking at native herbs and seasonings. And just describing some of the different herbs that are available or are around, that you could forage for, if you would. This one I thought was really interesting, which is the staghorn sumac. It's northern sumac, grows along ditches and on the borders of forests. Its deep red berries have a citrusy tang. Interestingly enough, it grows in upper Midwest and Northeast there is a difference. Months ago, I remember going into a restaurant, the Caspian, actually. There was a Middle Eastern, I want to say, maybe store where you could buy herbs, as well as like olive oil, and sumac just happened to be one of the items that caught my attention as I was going through the entire store itself. And the shop owner made it a point to mention to me that sumac, of course, can be found here in Minnesota. However, it's poisonous. So sumac berries that you find here, they're white. All the others are red, or have a ruddy color to them. So if you ever, someone ever tells you, hey, I have some sumac in the back of my yard or in the field over there or whatever, make sure you're checking the color of the berries, because poisonous sumac berries are white. And he brings that out more in the book too, but it just caught my attention because of the fact that folks are saying, he let me know that sumac does grow here. That's why they really kind of just concentrate on having it imported rather than relying on any sumac that's here. So, but it's a great book. Again, I've got a lot of cookbooks that I've got to go through. I'm still, there's the Moroccan one, there's one from Jacques Pepin. I'm excited for them. But you can't be a master and I'm not trying to be a master, but you can't master everything all in, what, 3 or 4 months. But it's good reading material, and again, I hope that I will have an opportunity to learn more about the cuisine, because it's, you know, we're talking about plant-based lifestyles and so forth, and at times, and the Sioux Chef's Indigenous Kitchen really does have information on there regarding more living a plant-based lifestyle. So keep in mind, folks, that you know, this is a show that's open to conversation. Next week, I'm excited to talk about a subject that this past week I had an opportunity to go to KFAI, which is kind of a sister low power radio station, and was sharing in a conversation with Chef Tunde Wei. He's a Nigerian chef, and Mr. Al McFarlane, who is the host of creator and host of Conversations with Al McFarlane, invited me to just kind of share a point or two as an individual that is talking about food, having conversations about food, and how it affects people of color. And as I've always said, that food brings people together. I just learned that it's not something that was, oh yeah, the Un-Bougie foodie has said this, or I guess it's just something that is a standard mindset. It's comfort. You know, people feel comfortable when they have food. Really good food, and so conversations that might be difficult to have, or being able to talk out maybe a specific issue or problem or whatever, food helps to facilitate that. And I had a number of great questions that I was going to ask him, but I'm going to save that for next week because I really want to delve into that. So keep in mind that the conversation is going to be, it's going to be a serious one. It will still be, trust me, it will still be lighthearted. But it will be on the topic of culinary cultural appropriation. And what that actually means in our society. Specifically in the culinary world, if you would. But just even as foodies or food bloggers, people that talk about or write about foods, or individuals that have shows, you know, it's really interesting how certain points, you know, in my research, I was finding out that certain things that either we say or how we write them, we can ourselves be, if you would, guilty of culinary cultural appropriation. And I really want to open that conversation up for you. So think about questions that you might have, or maybe comments that you feel towards that. And if you're wondering, well, what does this really mean? Culinary cultural appropriation. Let's just say, you know, we'll give you culinary cultural appropriation, the modifying of recipes without respect of someone else's culture, and then introducing a cuisine as if it's your own. So take that and, you know, think about what that really means, and how, you know, as food bloggers, as I mentioned already, food bloggers and reviewers and so forth, how we might be guilty of that as well. It really caused me to take a step back, because I am now gratefully, and I feel very honored and privileged to have an opportunity to write for a community newspaper here in the Dayton's Bluff and area that you might would find in the Dayton's Bluff area, Insight News. So please look for that those upcoming articles. But I'm very honored to be a contributor, but in writing or reviewing and talking about these different foods and cultures, specifically the cuisines, I should say, more than the actual cultures, but the different cuisines, because we have such diversity within our community of the different cultures. Can I be guilty of that? Is that even possible? And believe it or not, the answer is yes. So, again, I'm touching on this just to kind of like entice you and tease you to call in and share what your thoughts are next week. I'm mentioning this quite early so that you can get a feel for, you know, what does, you know, culinary cultural appropriation really mean? How do I understand it? How would that apply to restaurants, chefs, again, even food bloggers, or individuals that are food influencers that we see, you know, on Twitter or on Instagram? What really is the effects, or what's behind that? Another interesting point with that, along those same lines, when we refer to ethnic cuisines, using the word ethnic, what are we actually meaning by that? I've learned recently that some might take offense to that. And again, like I said, this week has been really eye-opening. This past week has been really eye-opening because there are, you know, are oftentimes there are words such as ethnic that may be used in speech, in writings, but in what context is it really meant? And even though we're not trying to think negatively on that, if you are trying to reach a more positive listening audience, what words are we being careful not to use so that we don't give people the impression that we feel that their cuisine is inferior to maybe American standard cuisine? Do we complain sometimes about a certain cuisine might smell too much? I mean, we live in apartment complexes, or we live next door to someone or whatnot. How are we feeling towards, you know, that type of cuisine or the family that's making it? So just keep in mind, again, next week's conversation, 10 o'clock. Please make sure that you're here and that you're listening, because I would really love the opportunity to share with you all the conversation. Again, the topic is going to be culinary cultural appropriation and really what that means for us. And not just even for those that are bringing you suggestions about foods, but what about yourself? Do you feel that you might be guilty of that? So definitely ask yourself that question and make sure you join the conversation. Make sure you join the conversation. It's coming down to the holiday season and probably thinking, okay, well, what am I gonna make for the holidays? Yeah, there's so many different things that you could choose from. I won't say that I just drew a blank, but I was getting to, do you really want to feel that you have to cook? You could always get your Groupon. Yeah, so we're going to talk about that very briefly. We're going to have one. It might be a little bit, let's just say that you wanted to go out, want to take your family out. Well, for Get Your Groupon, it will, here is one for Aqua Restaurant and Bar. Dinner for two or four at Aqua Restaurant and Bar, that's in White Bear Lake. St. Paul also. But here you have a choice, two choices. So there could be dinner for two, and that's Sunday through Thursday. That's at $59.99. Regularly, that's $100. So you're paying $59.99 for $100 worth of wonderful cuisine and food. Or you can purchase dinner for four, which is Sunday through Thursday at $119. Which is a savings of 40% in both of those instances. They offer a number of different courses that are available. And here's just an example for dinner for two. You get the first course will be veal, pork, and beef Sicilian meatballs with tomato demi glaze. The second course would be a classic Caesar salad with garlic bacon or garlic baked croutons. I'm saying croissants. Roasted hen of the woods mushroom soup, apple manchego cheese, and chive salad. I could go on, but visit Groupon to find out more about that. They are also the dinner for four, very similar menu options that are available. But if you're interested in finding out where they are located, first 4453 Lake Avenue South, that's in St. Paul, 55110. And visiting, oh wow. Definitely make sure that you to find out more information, I would encourage you to go to their website to learn more. That will be aqua dash restaurants.com, specifically White Bear Lake is for the location, but yeah, why not take your family out to dinner? We started that question, I was like, what should I make? You don't have to make anything, you can have dinner and at a really inexpensive price as well. So I mean, look, you're saving quite a bit. You don't have to do the dishes or anything. So make sure you get out there and get your Groupon. I know I feel a little subdued right now. I'm hoping I'm not coming down with a cold. I can't come down with a cold. I can't. So vitamin C, here I come. Oh my gosh. So we are actually near the top of the hour. So man, I really want to thank you very much for tuning in. It's been a pleasure, as always. I enjoy talking about food, different subjects, even if it is just a recipe or two. That cookbook, Sioux Chef's Indigenous Kitchen, I look forward to a good read on that. Remember, as I mentioned, there is going to be a book signing at Mill City Museum at 2:30 and at 2 p.m. So if you're interested, you can get a chance to meet Chef Sherman and maybe Beth Dooley, and get a book signed. Why not? It's possible I'm going to go out there and get my book signed. Thank you all so much for tuning in to the Un-Bougie Foodie. Once again, keep in mind that I am here every Saturday at 10 a.m. Right here on WEQY 104.7, the voice of the East Side. If you once again would like to follow me, please do so on Facebook. That is the Un-Bougie Foodie. Instagram is the_unbougiefoodie. Twitter at unbougiefoodie. And then lastly, if you have a comment, question, suggestion, something that you would like to share, please leave me an email message at theunbougiefoodie@gmail.com. And I will definitely respond to you. And even if you'd like, we could have a conversation and share your suggestions or question, if you would, on air. So, thank you again for tuning in. Listen for us next week right here on 104.7 FM, WEQY, St. Paul. As I end the show, as always, I want to encourage you never to let anyone tell you what type of foodie to be, because really, it is all about the food. Until next time, folks. Peace.